Chapter 7, Prince of Ropers. Meanwhile, Patrick Terrell was still looking for his roper. Walking along LaSalle Street in downtown Chicago, Terrell discussed the problem with his friend Charles Dean. In his work as a lawyer, Dean had occasional dealings with shady characters. He had a possible roper to recommend. The man's name was Louis Sweagles, though he also went by John Morris and a few other phony names. Sweagles was in his late 20s, of average height and build. He was talkative, funny, a natural-born entertainer. He'd grown up in Wisconsin and run off at 13 to become a sailor. Later, back in the Midwest, he started stealing horses. Like all good ropers, he was known to other criminals and had done time in prison. In the Wisconsin State Penitentiary, he'd met plenty of county men and had a basic idea of how their world operated. Now Sweagles was here in Chicago, married, trying to go straight. "He's anxious to be employed," Dean assured Terrell, "and has knowledge of certain counterfeiters and their operations that might make him valuable." Terrell said he was intrigued. Dean took him to meet the man newspapers would soon proclaim the Prince of Ropers. Terrell and Sweagles talked on the street later that morning. "Sweagles and myself walked around a few blocks," the operative wrote that night in his report to Chief Washburn. He said that he knew all about the case of Jack Hughes. That got Terrell's attention. He moved slowly, though, wanting Sweagles to understand what he was getting into. As a roper, he'd be expected to worm his way in with Hughes and his pals. Once he had their trust, he could earn money by selling Terrell bits of information about their plans. It was a dangerous way to make money, possibly deadly. Criminal gangs are not gentle with men caught squealing to the cops. Sweagles understood and wanted the work. Terrell told him to check out a saloon called The Hub, where Hughes was reputed to hang out. Sweagles went right to The Hub, walked in, and ordered a drink. Just to be friendly, he bought one for the bartender, Terrence Mullen. Mullen took the drink, but kept his distance from Sweagles. He never liked to talk much with strangers. Sweagles didn't force it. He dropped into The Hub often over the next couple of weeks. He was always smiling, always telling funny stories to other customers. He let slip a few hints about some time spent in prison, but offered no details. On August 28th, while Sweagles was drinking and cracking jokes at the bar, Jack Hughes walked in. One of Sweagles' new friends pointed Hughes out. Sweagles may not have seemed too interested, but as soon as he finished his drink, he left the bar and hurried to Terrell's office with the update. Terrell immediately headed over to The Hub and found Hughes sitting at a table. "Is all the money in your pocket good money?" Terrell demanded. "Never have any other kind," said Hughes. Terrell told Hughes to empty his pockets. Hughes pulled out $6 in paper money and a bit of change. "No, Connie." Terrell hauled Hughes to the police station to face older charges of passing counterfeit currency. The cops photographed Hughes, wrote down his description, and tossed him in jail. His friends quickly raised $2,000 to pay his bail, and by the second week of September, Hughes was back at The Hub. Hughes's trial was set for the coming January, but he could worry about that later. For now, he and Mullen had important plans to make. Terrell was impressed with his new roper's performance. He offered Sweagles the usual roper rate of $5 a day to continue reporting on the goings-on at The Hub. In particular, Terrell wanted some solid evidence to use against Hughes in court, and information about the higher-ups in Hughes's Connie ring. Sweagles went back to The Hub. Again, playing it cool, he didn't try to approach Hughes directly. Instead, he hung around at the bar, where small crowds gathered to hear hilarious tales of his past misadventures. Sweagles always made sure to casually weave in the names of criminals he'd worked with or befriended behind bars. Sweagles noticed that Hughes seemed to enjoy his stories. This gave him an opening. He chatted with the shover, casually mentioning that he'd read about Hughes's arrest in the newspaper. He let Hughes know that he was toying with the idea of getting into the Connie business himself. Hughes responded with some vague advice. He didn't know Sweagles well, and had no idea if the man was on the level. Sweagles continued patiently working his role. He stayed away from The Hub for a couple of days, then charged back and flashing a wad of greenbacks. He told Hughes and the other Hub regulars that he and his buddy, Billy Brown, had just cleaned out a tannery up in Wisconsin and made off with a bundle. Mullen listened with interest from his spot behind the bar. He and Hughes were still looking for a third man for Big Jim's Lincoln tomb job. Maybe Sweagles would fit the bill. They started asking around about Sweagles. The stories he told about past arrests seemed to check out. Then, during one of their rare stops at another saloon, Hughes and Mullen spotted a policeman known for bragging about his vast knowledge of criminals. The Coney men treated the detective to a few rounds of beer, then asked him what he knew of a man named Louis Sweagles. The detective proudly announced, "Why, he is one of the biggest horse thieves in the country." Hughes and Mullen liked the sound of that. Through September and into October, the 1876 presidential campaign continued heating up. Back then, candidates didn't travel the country shaking hands and making speeches. That kind of campaigning wouldn't start until 1896 with William McKinley. Before that, newspapers were the main battleground. Competing papers aggressively promoted competing political parties and politicians, and the partisan attacks were every bit as savage as they are today. Papers backing the Democratic candidate, Samuel J. Tilden, didn't talk much about Tilden. Instead, they hammered away at the corruption and scandals that had stained the current Republican president, Ulysses S. Grant. No Republican could be trusted, the Democrats proclaimed, least of all their candidate for president, Rutherford B. Hayes, who as a Union general during the Civil War had possibly stolen the pay of dead soldiers. There was absolutely no basis for this accusation. But Democrats knew that just throwing the charge out there would do some damage to Hayes. Republican newspapers blasted back with the strategy known as waving the bloody shirt. They spoke of the horrors of the Civil War and reminded readers that it had been Democratic leaders who had seceded from the Union and fired on the American flag, and Republicans under Lincoln who had held the country together. The papers suggested that Democrats were traitors, and their candidate Tilden was no different. Tilden hadn't served in the war, papers pointed out, and was probably still a rebel sympathizer and supporter of slavery. What's more, claimed one paper, Tilden was a drunkard, a liar, a cheat, a counterfeiter, a perjurer, and a swindler. No evidence was presented. Terrence Mullen and Jack Hughes were not exactly what you would call civic-minded citizens. It's likely they never voted in their lives, but they couldn't avoid hearing news of the upcoming election and the fierce campaign would impact their plans in one important way. But first, they needed that third man. Sometime in the middle of October, the Coney men pulled Sweagles aside at the hub. In hushed voices, they asked him if he'd like to make a little money. Maybe, Sweagles said. What was the lay? Body snatching, they told him. A very rich man had just gone toes up in Kenosha, Wisconsin. They were going to go up there, dig up the corpse, and hold it for ransom, figuring the family would pay handsomely to get it back. Sweagles must have been shocked. He thought these guys were finally going to invite him into their Coney ring. This grave-robbing thing came out of nowhere, and the roper sensed it was some kind of test. He said he needed a little time to think over the offer, maybe to check out the penalty for body snatching in Wisconsin. Sweagles left the bar and walked to the office of Charles Dean, the lawyer who'd gotten him into the roper business. Dean listened to the story. He told Sweagles the plan sounded like a feeler. Hughes and Mullen probably wanted to see how Sweagles would respond. Wait a day or two, Dean suggested. Then go back to the hub and tell them you're not interested. Sweagles followed Dean's advice. Hughes and Mullen didn't seem too upset. Sweagles and Dean had guessed right. The Coney man had no intention of digging up corpses in Kenosha. They only proposed the plot to see if Sweagles would keep his mouth shut. Rumors flew quickly through the criminal community of Chicago. If Sweagles mentioned the Kenosha plan to anyone, the story would get back to the hub soon enough. A week passed. Hughes and Mullen heard nothing about a Wisconsin grave-robbing plot. Sweagles could keep a secret, they decided. The timing was right. Big Jim was pressuring them to get moving on the Lincoln job. A few nights later, Hughes and Mullen led Sweagles into one of the back rooms of the hub. They shut the door behind them and sat down to talk. Forget the Wisconsin job, Mullen told Sweagles. The lay was still grave robbing, Mullen said, but the new idea was much bigger than the Kenosha rich man. Mullen explained the plan that he and Hughes had worked out with Big Jim Kennelly. They were going to take a train to Springfield, bust into the Lincoln Monument, and steal the coffin holding Lincoln's corpse. They'd load the box onto a wagon and drive it 220 miles northeast to the sand dunes along the shore of Lake Michigan. The beauty of the dunes was that wind would quickly blow sand over their wagon tracks. After the body was stashed in the Indiana sand, Big Jim Kennelly would contact authorities. The terms for the return of Lincoln's body would be simple: Boyd's freedom and $200,000 in cash. Lincoln's monument had cost about $200,000 to build, Mullen cacked. What is the use of the monument without the corpse? Spiegels was too stunned to respond. The silence in the room must have lasted an uncomfortably long time. His friends might think he was losing his nerve. He had to say something. I'm the boss body snatcher of Chicago, Spiegels blurted out. Mullen and Hughes looked intrigued. They knew they liked Spiegels, but didn't know he had experience robbing graves. Spiegels saw that he'd said the right thing. He relaxed a bit, his heartbeat slowing. Now he just had to back up his bold lie with a few body-snatching stories. We don't know what tales Spiegels told, but somehow he convinced his new partners that he was an expert on the subject. The Coney men welcomed him to the team.